see, does this work? Yeah, okay. Well, the slab allocators in the Linux kernel are a bit of an esoteric subject matter because most end-user user-space programmers never see too much of it. On the other hand, most of the kernel programmers constantly have to interact with it because they need small objects for their kernel code. And probably it's wise to first talk about what is this thing and why do we have it. Fundamentally, the basic memory allocation in the Linux kernel works only with page size, frame sizes. So you can ask for a 4K memory block or a larger multiple of those, high orders of those, from the page allocator. And so that's a basic operation of the memory subsystem. So if you want a small object for storing some metadata or stuff, then you have to go to the slab allocator, and it will get some larger blocks from the page allocator and hack that into pieces and shaves it all to various subsystems that need these small pieces. And these small pieces are often needed because, for example, for network operations, you need a small block to store the network information. You just need to store the scatter-gather list of all the components that go into a network packet and stuff. And so the speed of the slab allocator is frequently important for the performance of other subsystems. And I often think that this, some of the critical paths here are key to the performance of the system as a whole. We can see significant performance increases just by changing the latencies or the performance of the hot paths in the kernel. It also does caching, because the page allocator is a very slow beast, and you don't want to have too many trips to the page allocator, and therefore we are caching as many objects as we can locally and make sure that they are easily serviceable for any of the requests of the subsystems. Having said that, there is some basic terminology issues here. We're talking about the slab allocator, or a slab allocator. And if it's slower case, then it refers to one of them, of the allocators. And there are actually three of them. One of them is SLAB, the slab allocator. Then there's the SLOB, it's the slob allocator, and the SLUB, the slub allocator. So a slab, if you talk about the slab, it could refer to a slab allocator, the slab allocator, or it could also be referring to a slab. A slab is a page frame that is used for slab allocation. And so you got to be careful on what you actually mean when you talk about a slab, especially on email communications. It has been that way forever, and nobody has figured out a better terminology. So that's why we're stuck with it. So this is how the system components interact in order to get to the slab allocator. So the user space code does some system calls. System calls maybe do a file open, so the file system gets involved. The file system needs to store something to store the file metadata to for the file handler you're opening, and therefore it asks the slab allocator for a piece of memory, and then stores within it. The slab allocator may interact with the page allocator because it needs to acquire a large piece of memory that then can hack into pieces. And so this happens with various systems in various ways. And often the subsystems do different allocation calls depending on if they need page frames or do they need small blocks of data for the metadata. And so these calls are what is typically used by kernel code to do the allocation. So the kmalloc is basically indicating to the system, okay, I want this size of a memory component now, and give it to me. And you can free that again. Then the kzalloc is the allocation in the same way, but the data is zeroed. Zeroing costs time and touches the cache lines, and so you want to be careful, only use it if necessary. Then you can also do create actually special memory caches with special attributes. The kmalloc and k3 work just with abstract and default assumptions. You can tell the slab allocator that you want data to be aligned to certain boundaries. You want to have it ready for I/O. You want other things to go along with it, and then you have to use the kmem cache alloc, where you have to specify the cache. The Slab allocators are also NUMA aware, so you can indicate that you want memory for a special node for performance reasons. And if you have any questions, just ask the question before we get to the next topic, okay? And so a bit of a history on why these three things exist and how did we get here with the three allocators. So initially, 1991, what Linus did is just did the Kernel and Ritchie allocator. That's actually in the book of Kernel and Ritchie. It's a very compact allocator. And so it was there from 1991 to 1999. In 1999, we thought this was no longer sufficient. So Manfred Sproul and some of his friends got together and they read the paper that Mr. Bonwick wrote about how he did a slab allocator for Solaris. And they used that as a guide to create the SLAB allocator. So in 2004, I began to hack around with it and expanded it a bit to do NUMA, and it became kind of a monster. So I tried to tame the monster and couldn't do it, and so I came up with the SLUB and called this the unqueued allocator because the slab allocator resulted in an exploding number of queues. It seems that most of the memory seemed to be vanishing into some kind of allocation queue. And the SLUB queue approach is to cut this stuff out. And so we have three different design philosophies now for these allocators in the kernel. SLOB, the one that was there first, it's as compact as possible. It it doesn't waste any bytes at all, it makes it extremely compact, and so it was very useful in the beginning where we had small memory sizes, and today it's also useful for very small devices. The performance is a bit of a problem, but for uniprocessor designs, this is ideal. SLAB was designed by the Solaris developers to be as cache-friendly as possible, and it was especially designed to run the benchmarks very well that Solaris runs. And so it tries to guesstimate which objects may still be hot in the CPU caches and keeps them in queues. And so this guessing causes a huge number of queues to be developed where these objects are stored and they are constantly cycled and processed. Every 2 seconds they are expired and moved around. And there's a lot of fun going on there. And I had enough of that, and that's why SLUB came along. It's to just make it as simple as possible, make sure that the instruction counts in the critical paths are very low. And one of the problems that I had with SLAB, we had constant failures where we were not able to debug the situation. There would be a message, okay, somewhere in the kernel, in the SLUB code, a function failed. But it was really due to some kind of some subsystem corrupting the SLAB data in some fashion. And so what I added to SLUB is sophisticated debugging. And in particular, I was not able to enable the SLAB debugging function because it required a recompile of the kernel. And I had these huge supercomputers to run, and when they failed, they failed. And so I only had a core dump to work with, and so I had to wait through a core dump of gigabytes of kernel data to figure out what's going on there. And I could not start these things in a debugging mode. With SLUB, you can give a kernel command parameter, and even on a production system that doesn't have debugging compiled in, just specify a kernel parameter, and it will then instrument all your allocations, and usually it can find, even a production system, the values or the subsystems that corrupts it. And moreover, it's self-healing. So if it finds a corruption, it remedies the corruption, and it usually happens then that the kernel can continue. So your production system will still be operating, although at somewhat reduced speed, because it constantly needs to check its operations. And so I thought that was very important. And the SLUB allocator is currently the default allocator, and most of the distros use this SLUB allocator. So we have a timeline here. 1991, the initial kernel and Hang and Ritchie allocator. 96, SLAB allocator gets developed first, and 99 becomes the default. In 2003, SLAB is put back. That was because someone felt that the SLAB was too much of an overhead. So they reintroduced the one that was there before and called it SLOB. Then in 2007, I released the initial version of the SLUB allocator. And then there was a competition because I said that the SLUB allocator is more space efficient than SLOB. And then the SLOB guys got more motivated and they redesigned it a bit so that it could compete with SLUB. I still say that SLUB is better space-wise, but there are certain cases in which SLOB is better. So it stayed in the kernel. I threatened to throw it out, but it had to stay then. Okay, then there was still some performance regressions, and so in 2011 I did this SLUB fast path rework that made it much faster than SLB. And then in the last 2 years we have the move to extract common code from all allocators. We have now three allocators and there's a lot of shared code. So I created a common Slab framework and we are gradually moving pieces into the common Slab framework and only have the allocator specific data structures and those definitions in the particular file for the respective allocator. And then in 2014, we had a new talented maintainer, John Sung Kim, and he figured out he could make SLAB faster by adopting principles from SLUB for SLAB. And so now we have the slubification of Slab. That increased performance significantly, and but we're still way off on the fast path here. Some of the important people involved here, Manfred Sprauer was the guy who initially did the SLAB work. He retired, and he's still involved in some other issues, but no longer with the Slab allocators. Matt McCall, he brought SLAB in there, and he's the one who's maintaining it. Pekka Enberg has been active in various allocators and has been done a lot to improve the code. I've done the SLAB allocator Slab NUMA stuff, and I'm generally dealing with all the issues that are arising on these allocators. David Winches from Google has been using the allocators extensively and tests also extensively, and he's also developed his own variant of it. And then we have John Soo Kim. He's just became a maintainer and he's a very talented guy. Has been active now for 3 years contributing to the code, and most of the bright new ideas come from him now. Then we have contributors that are no longer there. Some people from India that did the basic design of the Slab NUMA code. Then Glauber Costa added a lot of the C group stuff that we're using today. And then Nick Piggin, he's written numerous Slab allocators that all were not merged, and he also increased implemented the SLOB NUMA support. This means that even the simplest allocator can now give you a memory on a specific node if you want that, and you can work with it. Okay, so what I want to do now is basically talk about the basic structures of the allocators. And so we're going to start with the simplest one and then go to the more complicated ones. So the SLOB is basically, it manages a list of free objects within the space of the free objects. And so in order to maintain a list of free objects, the data that's actually free is used. And so you don't have any overhead. The overhead is only because objects are free, right? And so this makes it very compact. On the other hand, this also requires that if you want to allocate an object of a certain size, you need to traverse this list to find the size, find a hole of the size that you need for your object. And then if this is a size that isn't matching exactly, you cause more and more fragmentation. So if you use SLOB and you have a load that allocates and frees objects in a very rapid way, you can defragment memory very fast and you can run into issues with out-of-memory situations, although you have huge amounts of memory still free. So SLOB should only be used for small deployments that don't do too much with memory. So the SLOB object format is basically you have two choices. One is you have a payload here. And we may have to pad that to get it to the alignment right and stuff like that. So this is the object if you allocate it and use it. If you don't use it, we store the size of the object there and the offset of the next free object into this free space. In case the object is very small, then we can just store the offset in here. So that way, even the smallest object can be used to store the free information for the next one. If the size is just one, then you don't need the size and you just need the offset. And that makes it possible to use the payload to store the information about the next object and create the lists that you scan. then all Slab allocators must use page frames, and they must have a page frame format. And this is the way that SLOB handles the page frame. So there's a page frame descriptor where you have the pointer to the free list in the page frame. In the page frame, you have the size of the free object, and then where is the next free object. So you have the green zone is a free object, then you need you have an allocated object, another free space, free section, another object, and so on. So it just points to the next free object in the page frame. And so you can just go to any page frame and look for what is free available and figure out a hole that fits you. Notice that the sizes are different. And this causes a fragmentation, and on the other hand, it causes a good fit on the initial allocation, because you can fit these holes exactly to the memory sizes you need, which is different from the other allocators. And there's also a global descriptor table for SLOB. Because of the fragmentation, an optimization was done to categorize the size of the allocations. So we say there's some small allocations, some medium, and some larger ones. That reduces the fragmentation effect a bit in SLOB. And then you have here the complete SLOB format, how it handles memory. Then next one is SLAB. It has queues to track cache hotness, so it's a list of objects. And these queues exist per node and per CPU, and also for each remote node. Because if you want to do free operations, you cannot simply take a log on the remote node. You need to queue it first to aggregate it and then do an aggregated free. And so with systems with a lot of CPUs, you get a lot of queues. And a system with a lot of nodes, you get an exponential growth of the number of queues you have in a system. It has very complex data structures that I'm going to show in the next two slides. I'm not sure how deep I should go into those data structures. I just want to give you an overview here. The SLAB memory allocator does object-based memory policies. So if you say you are in a NUMA system and you want to spread objects across all nodes, for each object it will take a different node. And this means that there's overhead of management of the NUMA locality for each object that you allocate. That is one of the reasons why SLAB is slow. And one of the key things here is in order to keep the data structures and the queues ready for allocation, it has to track which objects are cache hot. And that means every 2 seconds it will assume that the objects have cooled down a bit, and it will go through all the queues and throw out the objects that are a bit older. And so if you have a real-time system or an HPC system, the SLAB allocator will kick you every 2 seconds with a large scan of its own memory and interrupt you for a significant period of time. We had one of the systems at Ames National Labs at NASA running this thing with 4K CPUs. And so the time address are spread out over all CPUs, right? So you have 2 seconds and then 4,000 CPUs, something's always going on. And so the MPI jobs were delayed by about 50% just because of the cache optimizations in the SLAB allocator. And the other effect was because there was a system and a huge number of nodes, about 5 to 10% of the memory of the system was just gone on boot up because it pre-queued all these things. And if you were using this very intensively, the amount of memory lost due to free objects being in queues increased significantly. So this was a kind of a case of the vanishing memory that vanished into the queues, and that was not too good. That's one of the primary motivations that I had on writing the SLUB allocator. The SLAB allocator has a very sophisticated free list management. So you remember SLOB has a pointer to the next free object. That would mean you have to access multiple cache lines. We don't want to avoid that. And so what we have here is in the beginning of the page frame, we have a table of all the free objects. So you can just take the first n objects and you can get the pointers to the first five objects that are free, for example, without touching the objects, and only touching one cache line. So that was made also for benchmarking purposes. And today we have the Jones who optimized this last, and so one of these entries is always a byte size, so we can actually index up to 64 objects in the first cache line without touching the objects. The other allocators would have to do 64 cache line accesses. That is a key optimization. On the other hand, this also means that the there's overhead now in the page frame. There's more memory lost now because you have to take memory away for the extra free list. The objects need to be aligned at certain boundaries, so you have to add padding in various locations. And also, the slab supports coloring. This means if there's a cache association of very low quality, it can avoid placing objects always at a zero offset. And that also causes additional waste of memory. So SLAB is the most memory inefficient allocator that we have. And then we have the slab object format. It's very simple. You have the payload. And if you don't have it allocated, it's just free and it's not never being touched. And it also supports debugging modes. If you are switched on debugging modes, you need to recompile the kernel for that. You have a red zone where you can check that the subsystem didn't write past the end of the object. It can track who was the last one that touched the object, and it has some padding at the end, as everyone has for alignment purposes. And so this is a kind of a brief structure of the page frame. All CPUs have an array cache structure that is per CPU. The array cache structure tracks pointers to free objects that are cache hot that could be accessed and could be used later. And so these pointers can point to the free objects in multiple slab pages. So there's no association here. And this means that the locality of access is not preserved in slab. Then there's a page frame descriptor, where you can figure out where does the object start in the page frame, and the beginning of the free list, where you can index the find the free objects. And it's very interesting because an object that may be allocated that seems to be free may actually be allocated because it's one of the queues. So it's very difficult to figure out from looking at the page frame if the object is actually in use or if it's just on some of the queues. And the queues are massive and diverse. So one of the challenges here. And so this is the full thing. We have a cache descriptor that has the cache arrays for every CPU. Then we have the per node data, where we have per node groups of these page frames. And the per node data contains a list of these objects, also a shared structure. So if you have multiple per CPU queues, it has a shared structure where you can just free an object from the local per node per CPU structure into a shared structure, which then comes back to another CPU. Because the L3 cache covers multiple CPUs, right? So it reflects that as well. So we are attempting here to build an object queuing structure that mimics the cache hierarchy of the system. And we're tracking which cache may it be and what is most advantageous for us to get. And then there's the alien caches for the remote freeing, which is the structure that grows the most with increasing NUMA abilities of a system. Then we have SLUB here, and the motivation here was enough of the queuing. Therefore, we're going to do an unqueue allocator and just cut all the stuff out. We still have a queue, but this is all just a linked list for the objects in each of the slab pages. It's not that each CPU has a queue. Each CPU has a slab page from the page allocator. And we are allocating objects from within the page. And so if you do multiple allocations with the SLUB allocator, you get objects that are in the same slab page. This also means it is covered by the same TLB entry, and you minimize the amount of TLB trashing. We also have the ability to have more of these per CPU pages, if necessary, for tuning purposes. We found out that we sometimes need more than one page per CPU that can be tuned. The fast paths have been written in such a way that they do not disable interrupts like Slab does, but you just use very fast per CPU atomic operations to do their duty. The objects are not allocated based on memory policies for each object, single object like in slab. So if you do slab and say you have an interleave policy here, you would take from one node to the other. If you do that with slab, it will exhaust one page and then take the next page from the next node and so on and so on. So it's page-based policies, not object-based policies. That is a bit different and may have caused a different NUMA effect if you're trying that. So it also supports defragmentation on multiple levels. There was just an LWN article published about what I said on Monday, which was very inaccurate, because this defragmentation stuff has been there since 2008, and it's working in production systems. This is the current default allocator. These are the SLUB data structures. Let's talk about the object format first. You have the payload, and you have the same as in the SLAB, the red zone, to verify that nothing evil happens here. Then it has extensive tracking and debugging information. You can figure out when was this object last allocated, where was it allocated, which CPU did it run on, which PID was it running, what NUMA node did it come from, and stuff like that. So it's very much expanded there. If the object is not allocated, then we have then we're using the payload for the pointer to the next free object. That's the same as in SLUB. And we can also poison the object if it's free, so that we can detect any access to freed data. Now, this is a page frame here, and typically you have, if the object is free, it has a pointer to the next free object. And if you see this, you see that there's actually two free lists in operation here on this page. On the one hand, there's this page descriptor, which has a free list that is over there. That free list is protected by a lock that has to be taken in the page struct. And so this requires locking operations. It's expensive, but it allows shared access to the queue in the page. And hopefully often this is the case that different objects are on different pages, right? This is only there for the case that two objects have to be updated in the same page from different CPUs. So you have one free list here, and you have another free list that's linked to the KMM cache structure. So when you dedicate a slab to be used as a per CPU slab, it takes the whole free list off the page frame and puts it into a local structure. And now you can use this free list without locking. It essentially allocated all objects to the CPU, and now the CPU can allocate one object after another without taking any locks. When the per CPU slab has to be retired, it has to spin these back into the page struct. But for the time that you do the per CPU association, you have two free lists going on. So what can happen is, while the objects are being allocated by the per CPU structures, the struct page can get remote frees from other nodes or other CPUs at the same time without internet interference. And that often happens. So a processor allocates objects and then does something that shifts it to another processor, which then processes the data and frees it up. Then it comes back in the page frame. Once this per CPU list is exhausted, the slab allocator will consult the struct page and see, were any new objects being freed to the page? And if so, it will stick with the page and just take the objects that were remotely freed and reprocess them. And that makes it very effective to kind of have a circular thing going around with neighboring CPUs. SLUB also has much more advanced diagnostic tools, and people often don't know about this, but there is a SLUB info tool available in the kernel source tree. If you compile this thing, it can do amazing things that you haven't heard of before. Maybe this is the first time you hear it, not today. It can query the status of slabs and the objects in detail and can show you how much fragmentation is occurring, what happened to your objects. It can control the anti-defrag and object reclaim in some fashion. It can also run verification passes over your slab cache. If you are suspecting that something corrupts your data, you can actually give a command to the slab allocator, scan all the objects and verify that the integrity is there that you can check. There's an extensive proc file system hierarchy called on /sys kernel slab. There's a hierarchy here describing each of the slab caches in detail. And it's a slab info tool interacts with that hierarchy and processes the stuff. So the verification passes depend on how much debugging you have enabled. And it uses all the debugging event information available to do the, as strict as a check as possible of all the objects that are in there. You can tune the slab caches while the system is running. You can actually enable and disable diagnostics while the system is active. And you can modify the slab caches on the fly. So if you want to compile it, Linux tools VM slabinfo.c, that's where it is. Compile it, and then there's these various, look at these four things, for example. And I'll show some of the outputs here now. This is a slabinfo basic output. You can see the slab caches and how many objects are in there, what are the sizes, how much space do we have, where are these objects, are they in the cache for the CPU, are there partial slabs, and you can see that there's a lot of fragmentation. And then it calculates the fragmentation overhead that's created right now and the efficiency of the allocator. And notice that there are some names here that are kind of abstract. The allocator is merging multiple slab caches that have the same performance characteristics into a single one. That increases the cache hotness of the objects and avoids overhead that is otherwise existing in the system. And that's why they have these ugly names. And the totals. This shows you what's going on in the system. So this system has 112 slab caches, and it alleviates 189 caches down to 84. So almost every second cache was merged into another one because it was the same as the other one. And as you can see how much is lost here, over 8.5 meg is lost just empty because of fragmentation. And there is other statistics here. And aliasing, this shows you which slab caches had the same characteristics and how the system merged them together. And there are some sizes that are just famous, like these are just great, pretty popular. The 64-byte cache here has a huge number of users. Various subsystems recreate these things, and that all gets merged into one of them.
Mm-hmm.
This is only active when you are in production configuration. If you enable any debugging mode, it's disabled. And you can also say on the kernel command line, slab no merge, and it won't do that. But for production configurations, this gives you the fastest performance and the most efficient memory use. Then the enabling of runtime debugging, this is key for production support. If you have a strange message in the slab allocator, it's usually not the slab allocator that's wrong. It's something going wrong with the metadata, and usually a subsystem has overwritten the boundaries of an object. So it's compiled in by default in all distros. Nobody often realizes that, and I get a message, your allocator is falling, and I say, okay, reboot this option, and then it says silence, because the option gives enough information to debug the problem, and it's obvious what the problem is. So there's a slab debug kernel parameter that you can specify on the kernel command line. If you do that, it will enable all debugging facilities and do the utmost possible to figure out what went wrong with your system. Do that, and you will have an excellent report on what's going on. You can also get some more sophisticated and just do certain things. Let's say you want only check certain caches, or you only want to do certain checks. Then you can get more sophisticated and can specify some parameters. Let's say you only want to specify the F. It's just some sanity checking. It's often done. But otherwise, I rarely have seen any reason to work with these things at all. If you have a broken system that you know where debugging, enabling debugging fixes it, because debugging also does enable resiliency and it will fix the situations that it can fix. If it does that and you want to have reasonable performance, you may want to disable as much of the debugging as possible while still leaving the system intact. And with these things, you can do that. And you can then tune the system that can still work, although it's broken, and it will work until you give them a new kernel. And this is a sample error report for after you enable debugging. So this means somebody freed an object that was already free. And it tells you where it was allocated. So this is RT64 PCI, so some kind of a network driver did that. And it then shows you the object, what the contents of the object is, and gives you backtrace on where this occurred, and then it fixed it. So the fix of this case is the double free, is we don't obey the free. We just ignore the request. This is pretty safe. If data is corrupted, it will try to restore as much as possible. Now, some comparison of the various allocators. So SLOB is usually most compact. Slab queuing can get intensive. It goes exponentially. And in Slab, you have the data reduction through the aliasing of the slabs. And Slab reduces the cache footprint and stuff, so there's a lot of things going on there. So I've just booted to see systems and seen how much memory is being used. And SLOB doesn't even have the numbers here, but it uses about 300 kilobytes more than the system. There was about 300 kilobytes of data here, whereas these here have much more data to work with. And you see that's the unreclaimable data is pretty high in SLAB. This is because of the metadata structures. This is actually about 4 megabytes more. Then performance comparisons. It's typically SLOB is slow, SLAB is fast. For benchmarking, SLOB is fast in terms of cycles. And so because SLAB can track the cache state, L3 cache, L2 cache better, it's sometimes situation is faster, but in general, SLUB is faster. And so did some ultimate tests here of the slab, fast path and slow path of performance. And you see here that the cycle counts for SLUB are the smallest. It's about 50% faster than slab. And especially in the concurrent case, you have significant benefits because the locking doesn't exist in the same way as an SLAB. And Hackbench, which is usually a good test to see how slab allocator impacts general system performance. And you see, generally, it's faster. I couldn't run SLAB because it failed. The Hackbench causes a lot of allocation and reallocation, and so it didn't survive that. It probably ran out of memory or something. Anyways, the system failed. Remote freeing is something pretty important. And because often in the subsystems, you allocate descriptors and then chef off the job to some other subsystem running on some other node, and it comes back to you. And so that is also where SLUB shines. I'm almost done. So future roadmaps here. We are still continuing the isolating code that is common between the allocators. And I wish we would do something more on the defragmentation front. The slab fast path is now also relying on the CV operations. So Jonsu has copied the slab approach to slab. And we just did some slab fast path cleanup. Also, Jonsu did that. I moved the preempt enable disable from a better config preempt performance. The RT kernel is very much dependent on the SLUB allocator. They got a 40% improvement just by switching to the SLUB allocator because of the efficiency of the fast path. How much time do I have left? Yeah, okay. So, any questions?
Questions? We have time for a few questions.
Everybody's happy and satisfied. That's good. All right, thank you for coming. Mm-hmm.